Hi, this is Devin Crosby, and welcome to The Process, where we feature personal stories of overcoming. I hope this episode inspires you and encourages you to see the good in your life. Let's go. September 2019, English is not your first language. You're picking up the language by being in a locker room with your teammates. You get on to the team, the Lynn volleyball team, and all of a sudden we start having this amazing success. And you're a core member of that success. And Lynn University has the best record in history of the institution. We go to the NCAA championships. We win the conference championship, or you do, you know, as a member of the volleyball team. And then you have all success, and all of a sudden 3 months goes by and we're in the midst of a pandemic. And then you find yourself in a refugee camp in Greece. Can you talk about that experience? Like, how did you get to that point? What led you to go there?
I mean, I was always very touched by the situation. I mean, I always watched like reports, and I read a lot of articles about the refugee camp in Greece. I couldn't believe that people had to live in this kind of conditions, like such a misery, and it really touched me always. And the season got canceled. I was like, okay, I can do two things. I can stay at home and make a lot of money, because, you know, I go to school, so there was enough to do. Or I can do another thing, and that's I'm going to the refugee camp that I always wanted to go to, and to help the people there. I mean, I always wanted to show them like some compassion, because you know, I believe that people all deserve like a peaceful life. And
there at the refugee camp, like, what nationality, what religion, who's there?
Yeah, most of the people in the camp, they are from Afghanistan and Iran, Iraq, Congo. But there are like multiple nationalities. They come from
really
the world. Yeah, but it's like this camp is in Lesbos, and Lesbos is very, very close to Turkey.
Okay.
So yeah, that's the reason that they go by boat from Turkey to Greece. And then they are stuck in the camp, and then they have to live there for most of the time, like more than 1 year, like almost 2 years, because the asylum process takes a very long time. People don't have another option than living there in tents, with no showers, no toilets, only a few dixies. The tents are, especially now, always flooded, and it's like extremely cold. Imagine you have only like one pair of clothes, so when it's wet, it's wet. It's not, you know, you can't do anything. So
the camp that they're in, it's from what I've been able to read in some of your blog posts, is that there are over 20,000 people in this particular one, or maybe even more, but it's way more people than it should be at the camp.
Yeah, so in the like before September, there was like Camp Moria. Was supposed to be like a temporary camp. It started like, it was built in 2015, like in the beginning of the world crisis, when it all started. When people started to come to Greece. But like last year in January, there were already like 20,000 people. So it was extremely overcrowded. People lived in tents, but they also built their own structures. You know, the camp was just a small part, because everybody lived outside the camp. So yeah, it was like big. But then on September 8th, I mean, I was there for only 1 week. And then like something really bad happened, like a humanitarian disaster. Like I checked my phone in the middle of the night, and then I saw like that there was a fire. And yeah, fires were, I mean, there were often fires, but not like this kind of fire. This was like,
why so many fires, Ruth?
It's just like, it happens so fast because it's so overcrowded. So when something starts to burn and you don't have another option than using the fire to cook, to warm yourself. Like,
I see.
So when it starts, it spreads like so fast.
I see. Ruth, can you talk a little bit about the typical day when you were there at the refugee camp, maybe from the morning until when you were done at the end of the night? What was a typical day like?
Yeah, it's hard to describe because before the fire, it was different, of course. And after the fire, we did a lot of distributions. We tried to do like good food and drink distributions and blankets during the nights and days. So that was very different. But then we had a new camp, and the new camp was again very bad. Like the conditions are still very bad, but okay. Because then there was also a big hill in the camp, and they had a kind of a flat area. You know, I was still like the volleyball player there. So I saw that place. I was like, oh, we can play sports here. You know.
Yeah. Coach Maluski is probably very happy that you're still playing volleyball.
Yeah, I played in the camp. But then I realized, like, okay, maybe we can do something with that, because, you know, people are all always stuck in their tents, and loneliness is like a big issue, and yeah, boredom, of course. So I asked the organization that I was working for, like Euro League, like, okay, can we start sports? Can we do something with that? And they were like, yeah, you can do it. So
wow.
I was like, okay, let's do it.
Wow.
So first of all, we went to the single men area, because the single men are a group. It's a group that is almost was often forgotten.
Mm.
And they live in like big rubbles with 150 people, like all next to each other in beds.
Wow. Yeah.
So there's no privacy or anything. And we went to the rubble, and before we bought, of course, like a ball. We just bought a soccer ball and a volleyball, and we didn't have any equipment, of course. But
wow.
So that's how we started. And then I'm like, okay, do you want to play soccer or volleyball? And you know, it's in the beginning it was hard because, yeah, when you're like depressed and like, yeah, you know, you like leaving your place and.
Yeah.
But okay, so then they came and they had so much fun. It was so nice to see that like the guys who were first in the tent that were laying down on their beds came to the hill, and they were playing together and smiling.
Oh.
They told us like, yeah, last time that I played was 1 year ago, and now I play again, and now it's, you know, they got the same feelings again. So it was that was awesome to see. And also how all the different cultures came together, because, you know, in the camp it's hard because every different nationality and culture has to deal with each other, and they have like different cultures. Mm. Sometimes it's hard, but when they play sports, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's the power of sports.
If you can't play volleyball, it's fun. Let's play.
Yeah, right. Where did you grow this heart for wanting to help people? Because I love what you have said. It's so direct when you say that you just want to see people live a peaceful life. Everyone is valuable. I think I read something you wrote. Everyone's valuable. Where did that come from?
First of all, I'm a Christian, so I think that's also, I've always felt like it's important to help other people, because, you know, we are all like, we are sharing the same world, but we don't get like the same opportunities. And I mean, that's just because I was born in the Netherlands, I was born in this family, and that's the reason that I got all these opportunities, that I can study here now, for example, or I studied in Amsterdam. I have drinks every day. If I want water, I can go to the tap to get water. I can have food, like I can take a shower, like all the basic stuff what we often take for granted is like so much more than that. And I think, yeah, I've always felt that it's not fair that, you know, that I have all these opportunities and that I got all these opportunities, and that so many people in the world don't have these opportunities. And it's not because they are different, or like, I think we believe we are all the same people. We are just human, you know? Mm-hmm. So I really want to share that with other people as well, and to share, yeah, like my opportunities with them, to just, I hope that I can just be a small part, you know, like, I don't know. What I learned, like, in the camp is that first I always thought that it was important to do something big, because big things make a difference.
Yeah.
Then, yeah, so then, for example, in the camp, you have to say, like, many, many times when you work, many times you get questions and you can't do anything. Like, many people ask for a better place to live, for example. But yeah, no other place, so you can't do anything about it. So often you have to say, like, okay, I'm sorry, but I can't do anything. But yeah, then there was like a woman, and she came to me, and she was like, because I apologized again, like, I'm sorry, I can't do it. And she was like, no, why do you say sorry? I said, yeah, because I can't do anything. And then she was like, no, don't say sorry. I'm already so happy that you just listened to me and that you, like, take the time to be here and to see where I live. And, you know, like, yeah, she said, like, it's not important that you can do something for me. It's already important if you, yeah, you know, it helps me a lot when you just listen to me and listen to my story. And when you come to my tent to drink tea. And I was like, wow, that's so different than what I expected, because you have the feeling that you can't do anything because it's not something, you know, you didn't do something. But then she said, no, but you are here for me and you show me that I'm human. And I was that's
powerful. I could see that, Ruth. I really could. But let me ask you this question, Ruth, and think about it in this way. Is you've been here now in the United States, here at Lynn University. You've been with students from all around the world, because we're, you know, a very international institution. And now that you have your teammates on the volleyball team, I'm sure you know other student athletes at Lynn with all different types of, let's say, access and resources. What did you learn during your experience in the refugee camp that you think that can maybe help others?
I mean, what I already said, like, we are just very lucky that we are in this position, that we can work for a university like this, or that we study here at Lynn University. I mean, that's just an example, but all the basics that we take for granted, it's like, yeah, it's a luxury. But a lot of times people don't really realize that, and they just, you know, they just take it for granted.
As we kind of come to a conclusion is, you know, at Lynn, we have, you know, spirit, service, and strength. And you said a lot of things in this conversation that tie into those nine attributes that we have. Is there any one particular word that maybe connected with you the most through this experience?
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, all the nine words are very important, I think. but yeah, I mean, the most important thing is, I think, to stay humble. I like to be there for others, so others minded.
Humility and others minded, yeah.
Humility, because, yeah, I mean, I've said it like 1,000 times now, but I can repeat it again. It's very important to be there for somebody else.
Thank you for watching The Process. Check out more episodes on LynnFightingNights.com.